You are listening to a sermon by Pastor Christopher Salley of New Life Christian Fellowship Church.
I wanted to end our time together exploring Nehemiah and this subject of revival by talking to you about the challenge of leadership. Amen? The challenge of leadership. Nehemiah is perhaps the greatest biblical example of leadership that we see. And again, as you know, over these last 8 or 9 weeks, I'm not sure what it is, we've talked about these precepts of revival that are four and these 12 principles of revival, and I don't think we'll have an opportunity to review those again in the short time that we have together, but know that I've got those for you. Anyone who missed the notes or need something filled in, I've got it as a PowerPoint, also as a PDF as well, to be able to have it for you to kind of summarize those principles of revival that flow out of those precepts that we talked about: removing the reproach, responding to the roadblocks, recognizing the requirements, and relying on the resources. And the interesting thing about this revival is that the scripture says that the wall ended up being built in 52 days. Amen. It tells us that in Nehemiah 6, 15 and 16. And that's a remarkable feat, especially in light of the fact that it took them 23 years to do the temple. Amen. And verse 16 of chapter 6 says something. It says, "And it came to pass that when all of our enemies heard thereof, and all the heathen that were about us saw these things, they were much cast down in their own eyes." They got discouraged. Amen. At first, we were dealing with discouragement as we were building the wall, and now the enemies are discouraged, for they perceive that this work was wrought of our God. Amen. Revival is a God thing. Amen. He allows us, as he does with everything that he does, he allows us to get in on it. But when they organized themselves and they did what they had to do and they followed Nehemiah's leadership, we see that the wall got completed in chapter 6 in 52 days. And then the enemy was discouraged and defeated because they knew that this thing could only have been done of our God. And so I just want to pause in the middle. It's not really in the middle, but in the building project in Nehemiah 4, you know, we talked about the fact that the wall got built up to half the height, and then the enemy started to menace and do some other things. And so I want to tell you about the problem in terms of the challenge of leadership, and then I want to tell you the prescription. I want to tell you the problem, and I want to tell you the prescription. I want to tell you the hindrance to victory, and then I want to show you what the clearance is to victory. Amen? There's a problem, there's a prescription. There's a hindrance, and there's a clearance to victory. Amen? And it's right there in Nehemiah chapter 4. The hindrance to victory is really three things. No matter what you're dealing with in your life, particularly as you talk about a spiritual battle, but it could also be some other things that you might be dealing with in other spheres of influence and other like local environments. It could be applicable to your work environment, your family environment, any other environments that you need to exhibit some leadership in, some places where you want to see revival. Amen. In a general sense, but we're really talking about revival in the spiritual sense, is when we know that we're living below a place that the Holy Spirit wants to bring us and he can do in us, we need revival. Amen. And so, but the hindrance to that victory is really three things. And the first is, and we've talked about it in a different principles, but I wanted to bring it out in a different way to summarize how we're talking about revival. It says, "And Judah said," in verse 10 of chapter 4, "the strength of the bearers of burdens is decayed, and there is much rubbish, so that we were not able to build the wall." Amen. And then it says, and our adversary said, they shall not know, neither shall they see, till we come in the midst of them and slay them and cause the work to cease. There are three things that are right there that you will often deal with in a revival project. Amen. Anything you're trying to do that's positive in your life and you're trying to get back to a place where you need to be. These are the three things that will hinder your victory. The first is an endurance that is fading. Amen. The second thing is an environment that's frustrating. And the third thing is an enemy that's frightening. Amen. Those are the three things that when you're trying to get back to a place and God is trying to do something in you, the hindrance to victory, the problem is an endurance that's fading. And what do I mean? It says the strength of the bearers of burdens is decayed. Their strength, their energy, their endurance starts to fade. It is hard to keep up things, especially if you're not getting the results on the time frame that you thought you should get them. Think about every exercise program you've started. Think about every diet that you've had. Think about every discipline that you've had about, I'm going to read through the Bible in a year. And somewhere in Leviticus, somewhere in Deuteronomy, somewhere in there when the stories change and it's about the laws and the precepts of God, that all of a sudden your endurance starts fading. You might make it to February, you might make it to March, but it's hard to get through April and May and June because there are just certain parts of the scriptures that don't resonate with us the same, and it's in a different kind of wording, and it's not stories. It's not about King David, and it's not about Josiah, and it's not about those kinds. There's other things, and our endurance literally starts fading. That's always a hindrance to victory. Your endurance starts to fade. And I would tell you that that's in the arena of self. Amen. And we're going to find out in the coming weeks as we pivot from talking about revival to talking about spiritual warfare that there are really three arenas that we have to deal with in our lives and that we have to engage. Amen. And the first is the arena of self. If you could just get away from yourself for 5 minutes, you'd be fine. But the problem is you take you everywhere you go. And everywhere you go, there you are. That's why sometimes when you change an environment or you change cities or you change situations or you change jobs and you find out you still got problems, now the supervisor just has a different name. And it's the same issues that you had at the last three jobs. Now when you thought you were going to switch jobs and it's going to be fine in this environment, it's not. Why? Because you took you to that new job. But when you're trying to push through for a breakthrough, usually there's a breakdown before there's a breakthrough. And that's what happened here. They're like, listen, he says, let me give you a report, Nehemiah. I can see Judah coming. And he's out of breath. Listen, Nehemiah, I got to tell you, man. Listen, the bearer of burdens, their strength is decayed. And there is so much rubbish so that we are not able to build a wall. We can't keep going on. Why? Because we have an endurance that's fading. That's the arena of self. You got to learn how to deal with you. There's self-control issues. There are self-motivation issues, all of those kind of things. But many times, oftentimes, that will manifest itself before you break through in victory. You will break down because your endurance will fade. That's why, if you think about it, over and over and over, they're always trying to find a way, particularly when it comes to like exercise type programs. Listen, okay, you don't want to do 90 minutes, fine. You can't do 60, fine. You don't want to do 40, fine. Do you have 10 minutes? Do it. Do it in 10 minutes. If they can find a way for you and I to do it so that we did it in the car on the way to work, that's what we want. As long as your commute is 10 to 15 minutes. Amen? Because otherwise, at some point, your endurance starts to fade. But right there, you also see a second thing. It's not just an endurance that's fading. It's an environment that's frustrating. I talked to you about that rubble last week. And I told you about me laying that tile and how you start to look around at all of that rubble and the boxes that were piling up. And you just can become very frustrated because you realize that that environment is not necessarily conducive for victory. Amen. And so when you find yourself in a new environment, oftentimes you say, if I could just get out of this place, it would be different, but again, it might not be different because you bring you with you, but sometimes the environment gets frustrating as you do the work. Again, break down before breakthrough. You can't create rubble unless you're making repairs, amen? So they had to find a way to process and deal with the rubble, amen? The rubble is part of the process. Amen. If you're going to rebuild and you're going to rebuild the wall, you have to anticipate that there's going to be rubble all around. Matter of fact, as we were reminded in Nehemiah chapter 2, there was so much rubble in certain parts of the wall that Nehemiah decided to change his whole strategy and build along the crest of the hill instead of going down into the valley. He says, I understand what rubble will do. It will frustrate you. Amen. It'll frustrate you. You cannot make an omelet unless you do what? Break some eggs. You got to break some eggs. Amen? So remember that. There is that environment that's frustrating. And what environment are we living in? That's not the arena of self. Now you're talking about the arena of the world. We're called to be in the world, but not of the world. Amen? This is the environment we have. And it is what? Frustrating. The world is not set up for you and I to live a victorious Christian life. At every turn, we're swimming upstream. Everything in culture is diametrically opposed to a believer having success and victory in his walk with Jesus Christ. And if you don't understand that, and if you can't process that, I understand it will be frustrating, but let's make sure we are firm in this. Don't think the world is going to help you live a Christian life. It's not. It's not set up because the prince of the power of this world is diametrically opposed to the God that we serve. Amen? So the environment of the world is not changing. Matter of fact, the scripture says, and I love the way the King James says it, things will do what? They will wax worse and worse. It's only going to get worse. It's not going to get better. And an environment is frustrating. And then there's the third. As if that wasn't enough, you got to deal with yourself and you got to deal with the world. Now there's one more arena, and that's the power of darkness. That's an enemy that's frightening. Amen? An enemy that has a power advantage. An enemy that has a personnel advantage. And always has. And has an experience advantage. All of those kinds of things. And an enemy that is menacing and frightening. Amen? And so you add those three things together and you can see we got a real problem if you're trying to do a wall building project. And it's a problem that affects all three arenas in which we have to operate and have victory. And we'll find out in the coming weeks that we talk about the arena of self, what we need to do, how we need to engage in that arena in order to be victorious. We'll find out how we have to engage in the arena of the world and as we deal with the arena of the powers of darkness. But in short, in the arena of self, you need to flee certain things. In the arena of the world, you need to utilize your faith because this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. And in the arena of the powers of darkness, we are called to do what? Fight. Just a little preview for you. Flee, faith, fight. That's how we engage in these areas of problem areas and those areas of challenge. And so the job of leadership is to help us to identify or help you to identify the places where you're going to have a hindrance to victory. And it's going to be an endurance that's fading, an environment that's frustrating, and an enemy that's frightening. But then what's the clearance to victory? What did Nehemiah do that really cleared the way? What was the prescription? And it's two things in general that he did. And I really, really love I love both of them. But the first one to me is just a little bit more hidden. We might not understand the strength of it. And it came to pass, it said, when the Jews which dwelt among them, they came of us 10 times, verse 12, from all places hence we'll return and they will be upon you. And this is what Nehemiah did. This is the tactic. This is the practical move he made. Therefore, set I in the lower places behind the wall and on the higher places, I even set the people after their families with their swords, their spears, and their bows. Now, we talked a little bit about Nehemiah and that repositioning in the low portions of the wall last time, because we said that principle 11 of those 12 principles was we must guard the low points in our spiritual walls, not just for ourselves, but for one another. Amen. So we knew, and we talked about that being a process of accountability. But look at what he says. I set some people low and I set some people high. Why is he setting people both low and high? Because leadership must reposition. Amen. Leadership must reposition. Everybody say reposition. The people through instruction and encouragement to see the challenges for themselves. That's how you get real buy-in. Amen. My job constantly, and it is a struggle, is not just to tell you what I see, but reposition you so you can see what I see. Y'all didn't get that. You didn't get that. See, because then if you can see what I see and what the Lord is showing me, again, that's how did he build a coalition? When Nehemiah had the vision to stop, study, share, and secure, he had to share the vision with others in order to secure the help so that the response of the people would be, let us rise up and build the wall. We understand so that we won't be any more in reproach. We heard what you said, but now we're getting a better feeling for it, and we're understanding, and that's part of transmitting the vision. But when you're in the thick of it and you're trying to do the work, Nehemiah said, let me position some people low because we need to protect that so everybody's not in a hospital gown. Amen. We talked about that last week. But he said, let me put some people high so that they can see the enemy. They can see what's coming. They can see the challenge. They can stand on the top of the wall and they can see the rubble and they can see the enemy and they can see how I need to do some things all around here so that they can grab the vision and run with it themselves. Reposition. It's powerful from a leadership position. You can't just be, even in a work environment, if you just tell people what changes to make, if you tell them the how to do something, but you don't tell them the why, it won't be as effective. You say, you got to understand, we've got to do it differently than we did it before. Well, why we need to do it differently? What's the big change? What happened? And if you can't articulate to somebody so that they can understand the why, it'll be difficult for them to do the how. Amen? And so Nehemiah said, I got to reposition some folks through instruction and encouragement to see the challenges for themselves. The people need to see the enemy, hence the high places, and they need to see others, hence the low places. They need the high places so they can see the work. They need the low places so they can see the work. Leadership must reposition. And this was this instruction and encouragement. So leadership must reposition. The other thing leadership must do is remind. Reposition the people. Remind the people. And it was three things that Nehemiah said in verse 14 that you would be well served to remember. He said, and I looked and rose up and said unto the nobles and to the rulers and to the rest of the people, be not afraid of them. Remember the Lord, which is great and terrible, and fight for your brethren, your sons and your daughters, your wives and your houses. Leadership must first and foremost remind the people to remove their fear. Amen. You can't do anything if you are afraid. Amen. You have to have your fear has to be removed. Really, for there's three things, and one of them is here. That two of them are one's in Psalms, one's in 1 Timothy as a reminder, one's here. But you have to be free from fear in order to worship. You got to be. Did you hear what I said? You got to be free from fear in order to do what? In order to worship. See, that's what Psalms 27 is telling us. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Of whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked, even my enemies and my foes, came upon me to eat of my flesh, they did what? They stumbled and fell. And he says all of these things. And he says, though a host should encamp against me, I will not fear. Though war should rise against me, in this will I be confident. One thing have I required the Lord, that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. For in the time of trouble, he shall hide me in his pavilion, in the secret of his tabernacle. Shall he hide me? He shall set me upon a rock. And this is it. And now shall my head be lifted up above mine enemies round about me. Therefore will I offer in his tabernacle sacrifices of joy. I will sing, yea, I will sing praises unto the Lord. You can't do that unless you remove your fear. If you're cowering in fear about what the enemy will do or may do to you, you cannot worship. And you and I are called to worship. So David said, I'm a worship. And my fear is gone because the Lord is my light and my salvation. 2 Timothy 1:7 says, the Lord has not given us a spirit of fear, but of what? Power and love and of a sound mind. You not only can, if you got to remove your fear to worship, you got to remove your fear to walk. You can't walk like you're supposed to walk. You can't walk in newness of life like you're supposed to if you're afraid, because usually fear makes you freeze. Amen. It either makes you freeze or it makes you run the other way, freeze or flee. But he says, no, you got to remove. He hasn't given us a spirit of fear. He's given us the spirit, the power of love and a sound mind. You need to remove fear so that you can walk. Not just worship, not just walk. And then here in Nehemiah, you've got to remove your fear. Otherwise, you won't be able to work. Isn't that the Christian life? Worship, walk, work. That's what we're called to do. That's the whole ball of wax. And if the enemy can make you fearful, you won't do any of those things. It's game over for you. It's game over for me. We are stunted. We're not doing what we're supposed to do. And the enemy can go on and mess with somebody else, because you and I effectively will be eunuchs, spiritual eunuchs, not able to do anything, because we won't worship, we won't walk, and we won't work. So Nehemiah says, remove your fear, because it's time to do some work. The second thing he says is obvious. It says, remember. He says, remember the Lord. So remove your fear. Remember your Lord. Amen. Remember your Lord, who is what? Great and terrible, it says in the King James. I'm sure it says in the NIV, great and awesome. Remember the Lord. Amen. Who do you serve? Who do you work for? Who's the one that makes it happen for you? He's your light. He's your salvation. Remember who you serve. And for us that are people that are a part of the body of Christ, we have to remember this. When it comes to victory, we're fighting from victory, not fighting for victory. Amen? So he says, remember the Lord. And then he says, resist your enemy. Oh, you got to fight. You got to fight. That uniform you've been issued is not for parade formation. That's for war. And whether you want to fight or not, the enemy's coming. The enemy's menacing. The enemy is challenging you. And so the leadership must remind you and I that we have to remove our fear, remember our Lord, and resist our enemy. Why do you need to resist the enemy? Nehemiah makes it very clear. Because if you don't, guess what's at stake? Your brethren, your sons, your daughters, your wives, your houses. What does that mean? Everything. What's at stake? Everything. All that you have. All that God has given you. And particularly, it's like, listen, if you don't want to do it for you, do it for them. There's so many places in life where we need to step up, and the motivation has to be our families. And I'm thinking particularly of us as men. If we won't do it for ourselves, we got to do it for our children. Amen? Even when things are difficult and things are not working out and you don't want to get up and you don't want to do what you need to do, the motivation has to be, if I don't do this, something's going to get lost. Something's going to get missed. Something's going to slip. And if it's just, if I slip, then I'm slipping. Y'all know the rest of that. I'm not going to say it. And if I got my Nina, then you know I'm straight tripping, but that's not what I was going to say. That's Dr. Dre. But Nehemiah would tell you, don't slip. Amen. Don't slip, because your houses and your wives and your brethren and your sons and your daughters are on the line. That's what's at stake. And if we can't get motivated by that, I just don't understand what we can get motivated for. It's everything. Everything you've had, everything you've worked for can be lost if we don't resist and we don't engage the enemy. And so revival is a God-sized thing. And Ezekiel chapter 37 asks a simple question that really taps into revival. And it's in verse 3 as we close. The hand of God was upon me, verse 1, and carried me out in the spirit of the Lord and set me down in the midst of a valley which was full of bones, and caused me to pass by them round about, and behold, there were many in the open valley, and lo, they were very dry. He took me to the south side of Chicago. He took me to the west side of Chicago. He took me to Chicago Heights. He took me to Harvey. He took me to some places where I thought there wouldn't be bones, but there were bones there too. He took me to Flossmoor. He took me to Matson. He took me to the north side of Chicago. He took me to the North Shore. He took me to Lake Forest and Bannockburn, Glenview, and some other places. And he took me round about and caused me to pass. And he says there were very many in the open valley, and lo, they were very dry. And he said unto me, son of man, can these bones live? And I answered, O Lord God, thou knowest. I can't call it. It's a lot of bones over here. It's a lot of bones in Chicago. It's a lot of bones that can create over 700 murders in 1 year. It's a lot of bones. In a lot of places, in Auburn, Gresham, and Inglewood, and Gage Parks, a lot of bones. I'm not really sure about that. I'm not sure. Only you can tell me if these bones can live, because there's a lot of them and they're dry. And he said unto me, prophesy unto those bones. Do your job. Prophet, I need you to speak to them. I need you to talk to them. And then let me, come on somebody, do the rest. And say unto them, O ye dry bones, do what? Hear the word of the Lord. Is that not the solution to a valley filled with dry bones? Is somebody calling out and saying we need revival? Isn't it somebody saying, you know what? You need to hear the word of the Lord. And God says, if I send you to do that, he says, behold, I will cause breath to enter into you and ye shall live. When he says unto these bones, behold, I will cause breath to enter into you and ye shall live. there are two things, if you look at the rest of that passage, that were needed for bones to live. And you see the first one, he says, I'll lay sinew on those bones and bring flesh upon you and cover you in skin and put breath in you, and ye shall live, and you shall know that I am the Lord your God. So I prophesied as I was commanded, and as I prophesied, there was a noise. Come on, somebody. And behold, a shaking, and the bones came together, bone to his bone. The first thing you got to have, if you're going to have revival of dry bones, is you got to have unity, bone to bone. It's got to come together. Amen? Amen. You'll never see dry bones live unless the bones can somehow come together. And so there's got to be a unity, beloved, bone to his bone. Amen. And then he said the second thing is, and I'll cause sinew and flesh to come upon them. Then he says, prophesy and say, come forth from the four winds. So I prophesied as he commanded me, and the breath came into them and they lived. The second thing you have to have is not just unity, beloved, you got to have unction. Come on, you don't even know what that word means, do you? But I'm going to tell you what it means. Unction means that you have a spiritual fervor. The Bible talks about it. Another word for unction is anointing. You got to have the anointing of the Holy Spirit. 1 John 2 and 20 says, but you know better because you have an unction. You have an anointing from the Lord, which is the Holy Spirit. The only thing that can cause dry bones to live is a prophet standing in front of the people of God and saying, hear the word of the Lord, and you get some unity and some unction, and those bones will stand up like they've never stood up before, and they'll come together. And as they lived and stood up upon their feet, verse 10 said, an exceeding great army. If we want to revive the community that's known as Chicago, we better have some unity and we better have some unction from the Holy Spirit. And somebody standing in front of bones, understanding that they can live through unity and unction, and by prophesying and say, hear the word of the Lord. And if we can do that, we'll see revival in this place. Father, in the name of Jesus, we praise you. We thank you for all you've done.